In this episode, I had a fantastic conversation with Fred, CEO of Marathon, which is one of the biggest Bitcoin mining companies in the world, listed on NASDAQ with a current market cap of $3 billion. We discussed investing in Bitcoin mining stock versus buying Bitcoin directly, the impact of China's Bitcoin mining ban, why Bitcoin miners are making amazing profits right now, and why that is likely to stay for the foreseeable future. We also discussed the Bitcoin Mining Council, which was created as a response to Elon Musk's tweets, the Bitcoin Miami conference, Marathon's controversial decision of signaling OFAC compliant blocks, the risks with Ethereum's proof of stake versus Bitcoin's proof of work, and lots more. I really enjoyed this conversation, and I hope you do too. Hi, Fred. Thanks for coming on Sunny Bitcoin.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
So, Fred, tell us a little bit about your background, how you got involved with crypto, and your journey towards becoming the CEO of Marathon.
Long story, long career, I guess. I've been in the technology industry for over 40 years. I started writing software for commercial banks when I was in high school in London in the mid-late 70s. On punch cards on an IBM 360 machine. So back in the days where, you know, you had this nice stack of cards that you had to deliver to a gentleman in a white coat through a little glass door into the IT shop. And it was this mysterious room where these very expensive machines were operating. And you essentially had a budget. I could do one run per day, one program run per day back then. And it was mostly report writing, generating reports off of accounting data. Now, granted, this is in the days when in England, if you went into a bank branch at National Westminster, they still had a handwritten ledger where they wrote in the checks that you wrote. They didn't have any computer terminals. Quickly progressed, though, to more modern computer systems, and have worked in the areas of super mini computers, industrial computers, software, hardware, firmware, a lot of Internet of Things companies, a lot of AI, and automation type technologies, as well as digital media, gaming, ad tech, storage, data comms, kind of everything, internet services, et cetera. I had the good fortune of taking some companies public as CEO and doing a lot of M&A work, and then went to the dark side and became a partner at a private equity firm and bought and sold technology companies back when there was a great business of converting perpetual license technology companies to SaaS businesses. Did that for a full fund cycle and realized that I didn't want to be inside a PE firm, too much politics, and decided instead to just be an advisor to PE firms and global VC firms. And so built an advisory practice doing that. And as a result of that, you end up sitting on a lot of boards, you end up working with a lot of kind of high-end investors. And one of the PE firms that I was working with was very involved in the fintech space. And so spent a lot of time looking at fintech businesses, and having spent most of my early career in financial software related businesses, and having owned and run businesses in the commercial lending platform space and other areas, knew only too well how much friction there was in the payments business, the lending business, consumer credit, all of these areas. And I actually had the opportunity to work on some early Swift-based systems for payments. Swift is really a text-based system designed for telexes back in the 70s. And so when this whole concept of blockchain started appearing, it was very intriguing to me because it had two key features in my mind. One was the ability to take your data that was being held hostage by these large cloud providers, Salesforce, SAP, and others. If you could put it on the blockchain, then you could use any piece of software to access your data and work with it, as well as if you wanted to give permission to third parties, they could use it as well. So I was approaching blockchain from a business solution technology transformation perspective. But obviously, with a background in banking, and my stepmother happened to have been the senior economist at the OECD who wrote a lot of the regulatory frameworks for the East Bloc nations when they came into the OECD before coming to the EU. I was only too familiar with MiFID and all of these frameworks that countries needed to follow just to be able to manage payments, and thought blockchain would be a great way to solve payments. And so I started looking into Bitcoin back in 2016, 2017, And in 2017, started a project to build a crypto exchange that would sit on top of other exchanges and essentially provide a global liquidity pool. And spent a lot of money with lawyers here in the U.S. and realized the U.S. was the wrong place to try and build that business because the regulators in the U.S. just had no clue as to how they were going to deal with Bitcoin and exchanges in the space. And the U.S. is more complex because you have 51 jurisdictions, actually 53 jurisdictions you need to get licensed in. And so it's just a complicated thing. So being Swedish by origin and having lived half of my life in Europe, Zug in Switzerland was Crypto Valley, and thought, okay, let me go to Zug and see what we can do in Switzerland. Spent about a year talking with the Swiss financial authorities, FINMA, because I wanted to approach this from a perspective of, let me get licensed first. And if I can get a license, I'll build the platform. If I can't get licensed, I'm not going to bother spending the money to build a platform, because if I'm not licensed, the regulators won't let me operate. So went through the process in Switzerland and realized that the Swiss authorities, though they enjoyed talking with you about what you could do with a project around crypto, you weren't going to get a license as a foreign entity. It was going to go to a Swiss institution, ideally an existing financial institution. And you know, if you look today in Switzerland, essentially the only financial institutions that are regulated to do Bitcoin and blockchain are owned by Swiss nationals and are really associated with traditional Swiss financial institutions. I think there are only really two exchanges in Switzerland, right? So I then went to Liechtenstein, where you have a different advantage. Liechtenstein is part of the EU. Switzerland actually is not an EU country. It's part of the Schengen Agreement, but it's not an EU country. And so by being licensed in Liechtenstein, I would have passporting all throughout the EU. So got an exchange license in Liechtenstein and started building the project. And at about that time, a good friend of mine became the CEO of Marathon, and he was tasked with trying to figure out what business to put Marathon in. At the time, Marathon was a patent troll called Marathon Patent Group that owned some very interesting patents, one of which is the basic voice patent that Siri is built on. In the mid-2000s, 2014, the U.S. Supreme Court had a case called the Alice case, which contested the ability for software to be patentable. And unfortunately for software patent holders, the Alice decision by the Supreme Court essentially made it very easy to invalidate a process that was a manual process that software simply automated. So you could have a patent on a business process, but the software version of that business process couldn't be patented. So you could patent the process, but the fact that it was done in software didn't give you a second chance to patent it, if you would. And so many software-related patents became invalidated that way. So as a patent troll, Marathon Patent Group kind of was losing its primary income, which was licensing from patents. And so the management team had thought to go into Bitcoin mining and had made a couple of early attempts when there wasn't a whole lot of expertise around, and they'd set up an initial Bitcoin mine in an old building in Canada near Quebec where there was hydropower. When they turned on the fans in the building for the first time, there was so much suction, it actually sucked the paint off the walls. It was an old building, so a lot of flaky paint on the walls. And that ruined the miners they had. So they brought in a new CEO who happened to be a friend of mine. And he asked me to join the board. And this was very early in 2018. And so together with him, we reconstituted the board. And then we figured out kind of what the strategy was going to be. And we first had to get the company right-sized financially. It had a $4 million market cap and was technically insolvent. So we had to solve that, which my friend luckily is an expert financier. He was able to do that, raise a bunch of money. And then we went about figuring out how do we develop a powerful position in this marketplace. And this is now coming into late 2019. And we realized that there's going to be a halving. And typically before the halving, the economics of mining get very bad. So if you think about 2019, you know, we're still in this sort of remnants of the crypto winter after the 2017 crash. And so the ballsy move was buy every miner you could get your hands on, corner the market on miners. And then when the market shifts after the halving, if it follows historical patterns and the price dramatically goes up after the halving, you'll be in a position where now you have the arms, the weapons, and you just need to have power and hosting, and away you go. And so we started playing that bet out in early 2020, and we raised about $500 million of capital and placed the single largest order Bitmain had ever seen, which was for 90,000 S19 miners and about $250 million order. And placed that order and kind of rocked the industry with that news. You know, as luck would have it, price of Bitcoin scaled dramatically. We then went and sourced power through a power plant that had been essentially was idled. It had no clients, and a coal-fired plant in Montana. And we cut a deal with them to deploy about 100 megawatts of power and 30,000 miners. Started deploying that. And then in early part of this year, as the business started scaling, it came down to a question of, you know, a company needs a CEO who has scaled technology companies before, knows how to run a publicly traded company, and somebody who really has the ability to travel and be the face of the business. My friend, who at the time was CEO, had severe back issues. And so very difficult for him to travel. He was in a lot of pain constantly. And so we decided to swap roles. He would become the executive chairman. I would become CEO. And then I would kind of be responsible for day-to-day operations of growing the company. And so I stepped into the role in April of this year. And it's been a race ever since to tie up lots of power. I cut a deal with our fellow YPO friend, Dave Perel, for 250 megawatts of power in Texas. And we'll begin deploying in his new facility there in September. And super excited about that. You know, we've been working with Dave previously through one of our earlier hosting facilities. And so really looking forward to that, and looking forward to very exciting times. You know, the global hash rate has dropped. So it's all of a sudden, everybody is printing money. Quite an exciting time. And because of the constraints on power and just supply chain around transformers and things like that, it looks like we'll have you know, 9 months to a year of really great times before we get back on this kind of crazy growth path of the global hash rate, and it becomes a rat race again. But so we're super excited.
What an amazing journey, both for you personally. I mean, from mainframe computers to the future of fintech and banking. I mean, it's just an absolutely extraordinary journey. And for even for Marathon, I mean, it's just an amazing kind of journey from patent trolling to kind of, you know, be one of the significant players in Bitcoin mining. And I think I did an episode with Dave, which was fantastic. My first kind of episode on Bitcoin mining a couple of episodes back. So encourage the audience to check that out. What is the main product or service that Marathon offers to investors?
So we are think of us as a proxy for Bitcoin. So Warren Buffett famously was supposedly said, I've never asked him this, but it's been written this way, that he would never invest in gold, but he would invest in gold miners. Why? Because if you buy just the underlying asset, you only get that asset's appreciation. But if you buy the miner, you get the whole value stack, if you would, the profit stream. And if you think about Bitcoin mining today, it costs us about $5,600 to mine a Bitcoin. And with Bitcoin at 34,000 US, more or less, you know, it's a very profitable business. And it's a business of scale. And so essentially, you could go buy Bitcoin at $34,000. And if Bitcoin goes up 10, 15%, you get that benefit. Typically, our stock moves considerably more than that. And if you look at how the analysts are projecting our stock to be priced, we're considerably undervalued today. So you can look at our stock as kind of a proxy. And if you had bought our stock 12 months ago on, say, June 30th of last year, and you sold it on June 30th of this year, you would have had a 3,400% gain, where Bitcoin was considerably less than that. And even the S&P has done well, 38% gain in that same time period. And actually, with gold, you would have lost money. It's just been an amazing ride. And so, you know, longer term, you know, we'll continue to have great value because we're going to be having such high cash flow. By the time we deploy all of the miners we currently have on order and that are being delivered. And so by the time I have filled up Dave's facility in Denton, Texas, our revenues will be nearly, depending on where Bitcoin is priced, but if Bitcoin is at 35,000, let's say, I'll be generating roughly $90 million of revenue per month with roughly $65 million of profit per month.
So I want to unpack a lot over there because it's some very interesting numbers. But before I get into that, when did you get listed on NASDAQ? I know the stock is listed over there. When did that happen? And what's the current market cap of the stock?
So the company was listed, like many shell companies, it's gone through a lot of lives before Marathon got its hands on the entity. At one point, it was an oil and gas company, and then the shell was sold a couple of times over again. And then Marathon Patent Group bought it as a shell to do a reverse merger to go public. They went public through a reverse merger. This was kind of the popular way before SPACs really became in vogue. And so Marathon Patent Group has been public for a number of years. And then we just changed our name to Marathon Digital Holdings earlier this year. But the company's market cap today is a little over $3 billion. The market cap at the peak of Bitcoin, when it was at $60,000, our market cap was a little over $5 billion.
And some of the other publicly traded Bitcoin mining stocks are Riot Blockchain, Canon, Canaan, and Hive. I believe Riot is slightly bigger and the others are much smaller than you guys. How does Marathon compare with them?
So Riot is today slightly bigger than we are. By the time end of Q1 next year, we'll be at 10 exahash. They'll be at about 5 exahash. Their projection is to be at 7 exahash at the end of next year. We're going to continue to deploy more miners beyond Q1. So our goal is to try and achieve, it's aspirational, but we're trying to achieve about 10% of the global hash rate. You know, today, the company, we have no debt. We have 6,000 Bitcoin on our balance sheet. We don't sell the Bitcoin that we mine. We keep it all. We have a couple hundred million dollars of cash in addition. And, you know, we have, I think, 7 employees. So it's a very unique business in that sense. We outsource everything and we have the scale to do it at a price that really, if you were to compare the price of us buying a power plant and managing it ourselves and building our own data centers and managing it ourselves, the cost on a per Bitcoin mined would be the exact same as what we're doing today. And now we don't have the hassle factor of being a regulated power utility or having to deal with the real estate issues of a data hosting facility and all the employees and all that. So it makes it a very agile business model. So, you know, and Hive is in a number of different markets. And I think, you know, they're going to continue to grow. Frank's a great guy, again, fellow YPO. And I think, you know, we're all kind of in this business together. You know, it's a funny business because there are only 900 Bitcoin made a day. And it's kind of a zero-sum game. It's like, okay, I'm going to add 10% to my mining fleet. You're going to add 10% to your mining fleet. We're all going to spend a lot of money, and we're not going to get anything more out of it. So it's a crazy business.
Yeah. So I think currently you own about 7.3% of the global hash rate. That's what your website says. And from that's already a significant share of Bitcoin mining. And from there, the target is to achieve 10%, which is just amazing. Any other miners outside the US which are bigger than you or which you compete with at this scale?
You know, Core Scientific is private and they're larger than we are today. We'll be comparable to them by next year, most probably, though they continue to grow as well, obviously. I believe there are certain miners who are government-funded miners. My understanding is, for example, there's a mining operation run by the Venezuelan government or military, not sure which. You may be familiar or not that in Venezuela, they have a huge dam that was built to provide electricity for aluminum smelting. And the aluminum plant was shut down. And so they have all this cheap hydroelectricity. And the government basically took one of 3 main power feeds from the dam and is using it to mine Bitcoin, supposedly. But that's supposedly one of the largest mining facilities in the world. Don't know how many megawatts, but it's supposedly one of the largest outside of the US. Now that China's been shut down, right? Before China, some of the Chinese miners, I think, were bigger before that.
Well, that is an amazing story about the Venezuelan mining. I didn't know that. Is it true, Fred, that Bitcoin mining stocks are more volatile than Bitcoin? You kind of mentioned about, of course, the upside. When Bitcoin's price goes up, the stock or the prices of Bitcoin mining stocks goes up more. And the same has happened with you. But wouldn't the opposite be true as well?
Well, historically, the correlation was about 2.8 to 1. So if Bitcoin moved 10%, we would move 28% in either direction. What's happened is as we've begun deploying more of our miners and the revenue, and you know, we're now profitable, we're cash flowing quite well, and you know, Riot and ourselves are kind of moving along this same path of generating real profits. We don't move downwards the same with Bitcoin. We tend to move up very much with Bitcoin, but there's a floor to how low we go because of the value of our cash flows. And so it's kind of a growth stock that now is turning into a, not a value play so much, but it's really, people are able to measure what our cash flow is going to be. And then you do a multiple of that cash flow to estimate a stock price. So, you know, there are now three analysts covering the space. They cover both Riot and ourselves. They all have target prices for our stocks in the 40s. So, you know, obviously undervalued to where we are today, with an expectation of Bitcoin not appreciating a whole lot more. So, you know, I think we're maturing as an industry and maturing as an asset class, if you would.
And I guess in the long term, anyways, I mean, as a Bitcoin maximalist, I kind of feel like Bitcoin's price will keep going up. There could be short-term volatility, of course, which means that this could be very, very interesting, right? You have far more of the upside than the downside events, even if what I said is true. But that's really interesting. And you also mentioned, like, in, you know, you in the just a couple of minutes back, you were talking about the production costs of Bitcoin for you guys, for Bitcoin mining, and the current Bitcoin price and the massive profit margin that's there. How have you achieved this?
You know, scale gives you negotiating power. And so we're able to, in some cases, buy power at, you know, around 2 cents a kilowatt hour. And then, you know, your hosting costs on top of that. So you know, your blended costs come in at about 4.5 cents a kilowatt hour. Between power and hosting costs, including the CapEx for that hosting cost. So the only additional cost really is the cost of the miners themselves and, you know, whatever, you know, SG&A the company has as a public company. There's certain expenses, obviously. But, you know, it's one of these things where the incremental contribution margin is just crazy because our fixed operating expenses are so low. Yeah, if you were to compare us to Riot, there's a slightly different model because Riot now owns a very large data hosting facility in Texas. They bought the Windstone facility that had been owned by Northern Data before. And so they spent, in today's stock price terms, because they paid for it with stock mostly, you know, $250 or so million for a hosting facility that hosts lots of different third-party miners equipment. So they're now in the real estate business as well as being in the mining business. So from a capital perspective, you know, they now have a much bigger fixed cost base that they have to operate under. We don't have that type of limitation on our business. So.
And of course, there's also in addition been a windfall because of the China Bitcoin mining ban. How long do you think this is going to last? What are your comments on this whole situation?
So, you know, BitUDA just put out a good research report on this. They're basically projecting, you know, they had been projecting the global hash rate to approach 200 exahash by the end of this year. And with the drop off in the Chinese miners, which say 40%+ of global hash rate shut down, a percentage of that is going to Kazakhstan. So say 30% of that goes to Kazakhstan. That's kind of, you know, 15-16%. So that'll come back online fairly shortly. So where today the global hash rate is somewhere between 80 exahash and 100 exahash, you'll see it by the end of this year, according to BitUDA, about 145 exahash, possibly a little higher. The primary constraint to why it doesn't grow back faster is there's already a shortage of available power and available hosting facilities. And the equipment for transformers to build new data hosting facilities is severely constrained. And, you know, the lead times are, you know, 6 months, something like that at this point. And, you know, you could ask Dave, you know, what's the lead time to build a new hosting facility? It's not the concrete, it's all the steel and the cabling and the transformers and all that. And so that is a constraint that keeps new miners from entering the US market. And so they're having to go other places. But again, you know, you could go to El Salvador and take advantage of volcano power if you would, but you still have to build the power plant. And, you know, that's $1 million a megawatt to build a power plant. And then you've got to build your mining facility at the same time. And so it's a lot of CapEx. And many of the Chinese miners don't have that amount of capital. And, you know, there's a storyline or a belief that a lot of the pressure that's been on Bitcoin price recently is Chinese miners liquidating their Bitcoin holdings so they can invest in getting capacity other places. So again, if you believe the Bitauda forecast, and I think they're very good at estimating what they're doing because of how they get their data, you know, we're going to be in a very attractive time for mining really for the next, you know, 9 months to a year. And, you know, when you come, you know, in a year's time, just the North American miners between Core Scientific, Marathon, Riot, you know, Hive and others, we're going to be adding 40 to 50 exahash just us. Then you've got some Chinese miners adding capacity. So, you know, we're going to be at that kind of 150 exahash, you know, early, you know, at the end of this year, and come next year, we'll most probably be at 240 exahash by the end of next year and continuing to grow. So you can imagine if you want to have like Marathon maintain a 10% market share at 240 exahash, it means I have to add 14 exahash to my capacity next year.
That's amazing. And do you think this positive period, this, you know, unique positive period for Bitcoin miners, which may last for another year or two, is it already reflected in your price, in your stock price?
No, it's not. I think the institutional market hasn't gotten their heads around. You know, they look at, typical institutional investors look at projections of cash flow and historical cash flows. They don't realize that you know, the dynamics in this industry are that the only thing you control as a miner is your cost of electricity, your cost of miners, and the amount of capital you can deploy, put more miners out there. You don't control the global hash rate. You don't control, you know, obviously the price of Bitcoin. So you're just really having to be just operationally excellent at what you do. And so most institutional investors will wait to see the production numbers change for miners. Most public miners like Riot and ourselves, we publish our production numbers monthly. Marathon is a bit unique in that we operate our own pool and we're currently the only member in that pool. So anybody who wants to see how many Bitcoin we're mining on any given day can just go look at our pool stats. So it's a very transparent business. So until people see the numbers start trending upwards and realize the difficulty rate only adjusted on the 3rd of July, which is just a few days ago, we've certainly already seen the difference. Our block wins, and I'm sure other miners are seeing the same thing. And so the institutional investors are likely saying, well, you know, Riot and Marathon will equally benefit from this. And so, you know, it's kind of a wait and see game, I think. But, you know, I fully expect this to be a very unique year in the Bitcoin mining industry. I think the price of Bitcoin will likely stay within a band of 30 to 40,000 until it breaks through 42,000, breaks through that resistance point with a lot of momentum. And then we're most probably back at 50 and edging towards 60 again, and, you know, resistance kind of at 46 and 48 and then beyond. But I think that there are a number of things conspiring to drive the price higher. And by that, I don't mean it in an evil way. I just mean it's, there are subtle things that drive the adoption of Bitcoin that most people don't realize. So for example, NYDIG, which is a US bank and custodian of cryptocurrencies, they've cut a deal with FIS and other core banking system providers to enable most of the banks in the US, large, medium, and small, and all the community banks, to offer Bitcoin custody, buying, selling, and trading services. So when you add 300 million consumers with the ability to hold some Bitcoin, you have credit card companies that are now coming to market offering 1.5% to 2% cash back paid in Bitcoin. That Bitcoin has to be acquired somewhere, and miners are holding their Bitcoin. So there's no new supply coming into the market. It's sitting in wallets that miners. And so they're going to have to buy it from the open market. So these small incremental volume increases in the demand for Bitcoin, when you aggregate them as a whole, I personally think you're going to see the volume of Bitcoin, you know, Bitcoin demand going up. And as institutional investors come off the sidelines and come back into the marketplace, they've been kind of taking a pause, trying to figure out where things are going, because most of them came in at 30 anyway. So it's kind of break-even time for them. And now they're waiting to see how it moves. But as it starts to move, they'll come off the sidelines. And now you're going to have even more pressure on supply, i.e. demand is going to go up even more. And so I think you're going to start seeing more and more Bitcoin becoming captured by these institutions. If the SEC approves an ETF, they're going to have to buy Bitcoin. And so all of that Bitcoin is Bitcoin that will get locked up and taken off the market. So if you're familiar with trading in public company stocks, it's like what happens when a company starts getting a lot of institutional ownership. The free float of stock that's able to be traded in the market on a daily basis is reduced because it's being held by institutions that are long-term holders. And so, for example, Marathon and Riot were both just added to the Russell 2000 index. That means a certain number of institutions have to buy our stock and hold it. The same thing will apply in the Bitcoin market. As institutions start wanting to deploy 1% asset allocation to Bitcoin, well, there is just in the retirement funds, the trillions of dollars that are locked up there, just take 1% of that and deploy it to Bitcoin. And what does that do to the overall supply? Well, you're going to suck it all out of the market. And, you know, if we are at 18.9 million Bitcoin mined, something like that today, and there are only 900 a day added, and let's just say that that's all sucked up by, held by the miners, then you're essentially in a marketplace where the free float starts shrinking. And, you know, some people estimate 25% of Bitcoin that's been mined is lost or dormant for the long term. You know, you end up with 4 or 5 million Bitcoin is the only thing going around in the marketplace for people to buy, and that will drive the price sky high. So I'm a long-term optimist. I think short-term we're going to trade in this 30 to 40,000 band. But as soon as an ETF is announced, the SEC approves an ETF, and as soon as you start seeing some upward movement, it's going to be back off to the races, and it'll be very interesting to see. I think the unknown today is what happens at the next halving, and where is Bitcoin priced then? What's the global hash rate then? And most probably the only profitable miners coming into the halving in 3 years are going to be the largest scaled miners that have very low operating costs. It's going to be very difficult to mine if you're paying, you know, 8, 9, 10 cents a kilowatt hour for energy and hosting. It just will not be profitable for you at that level.
Some fantastic insights there. And, you know, you're talking about the classic supply squeeze. It seems, at least in the mid and the long term, that Bitcoin is and will always be bullish for the foreseeable future. You are a prominent member of the Bitcoin Mining Council. What is the Bitcoin Mining Council? When and how did it start? And what's the purpose?
So YPO, kind of confidential, if you would, the Bitcoin Mining Council started because Elon Musk started tweeting negative things about Bitcoin related to energy. And we in the industry know what our energy blend and mix is. But there was a lot of FUD, you know, fear, uncertainty, and doubt being spread. And the best way to counteract FUD is to provide real data that's concrete. And so Michael Saylor, who, you know, a fellow Bitcoin maximalist, decided that, you know, let's form a group of the North American miners. Let's publish our data. Let's educate the world as to really how much power we use, how much of it is renewable, what our trends are going to be. And that was the purpose. And so Michael organized a call with Elon Musk and a group of the miners to discuss kind of, you know, mining and power. And, let's just say that that call was informative for Elon, and that he came away from the call saying he was very interested to see what would come of it. And I think later on you saw him tweet that, well, if the Bitcoin miners can get the 50% renewable, you know, he'll be happy to re-engage in supporting Bitcoin. Realize, of course, that the reason he all of a sudden flip-flopped before was because he got a lot of pressure from his investors who said, wait a second, you're a renewable energy company. And many people don't know this, but if you read through the filings, Tesla only makes profit, only generates a profit because they sell renewable energy credits that they generate. And that's $400 million a quarter. So if you take that off their P&L, they lose. So he was under a lot of shareholder pressure, is the general belief. And, you know, some people suggest it was an individual at CalPERS, which is a California pension fund, state pension fund that called Elon and said, listen, you know, you can't be in the renewable energy world and promoting an industry that is not very green at all. So we went off and did our studies. And, you know, as luck would have it, you know, we made our agreement with Dave Perel, which, you know, essentially gives us a footprint that across our global fleet makes us 70% carbon neutral. And as you looked at the rest of the industry, you saw that, you know, we were actually about 56 to 66% renewable energy already, or carbon neutral. And so, you know, we collected that data and presented it literally a week ago. And, you know, now all of a sudden you'll notice very few people are talking about how bad the power consumption in the Bitcoin mining world is. It's kind of disappeared from the headlines. And so that was the whole purpose of it. So we're going to continue to educate the world on how we're using power, what blend of power we're using. We've all made commitments and said where we're going to be by the end of next year in this area, and we'll continue to do that. And, you know, the Bitcoin mining is the power consumer of last resort. You know, we buy the cheapest power out there. Typically, it's stranded power that can't be used. You know, a lot of people don't know that. So in the US today, for example, we generate about 4 terawatts of power on a daily basis and consume that. Of that 4 terawatts, 200 gigawatts, so roughly 5%, is lost purely in transmission lines. And even more energy is lost due to waste, meaning it's just not consumed. Because, you know, as you may be familiar, everybody has the expectation that when they plug in something into the wall, they expect electricity to come out of the wall. And if it doesn't, you don't like it. The power grid is configured for maximum power generation, maximum consumption. But that only happens at very small peaks during the day. And it's very hard to turn a power plant on and off to regulate the power it generates. And so there's a lot of power waste. So by working with Bitcoin miners to put their mining operations adjacent to power plants, you can have what's called base load balancing, which is basically a power plant can operate. So look at a nuclear plant, for example. Nuclear plant, you can't shut down from 1 minute to another. It's a whole lengthy process for it. So you could put Bitcoin mining on the grounds or nearly near to a nuclear facility. And whatever excess energy is not being used by the grid, the Bitcoin mining facility can consume. And when the power plant needs to feed more energy to the grid, they send a demand response signal to the miners, and we just shut off miners. We can do it in 10 minutes. And so we're the perfect load balancer in that sense.
Yeah, so many nuances to a very superficial debate. And, you know, thanks for giving more insights into this. What are your views on Bitcoin's proof of work versus Ethereum's proposed proof of stake, which is another FUD attack on Bitcoin's energy consumption, in my view?
Yeah, I think so. My personal view is, for one thing, Bitcoin as a network, not the cryptocurrency, but the network, is about ownership. It's a settlement network that shows who owns what. The Ethereum network is about utility. It's for building applications on it. You know, a lot of DeFi applications have been built on it and will be built on it. And that's what it's purposely designed to do. So two different purposes. Neither Bitcoin or Ethereum as a base network are very efficient at processing high volumes of transactions at low cost. They're both rather expensive and limited in what they can do. But by building side chains and sharding in Ethereum, you can get there. You know, Lightning does this very effectively in the Bitcoin world, and sharding will hopefully do it in the Ethereum world. The challenge with the shift from proof of work to proof of stake is you have to create an incentive for miners to keep mining, because at the end of the day, the blockchain still has to be operated. And if you take away the financial incentive from the miners to operate, there will be much fewer miners operating, which means that the safety and security of the network will drop dramatically. The other thing is, because proof of stake is based on who holds how much in the way of Ether, the logical centralization of the Ethereum network is that all the exchanges and banks will end up as central authorities controlling essentially what should be a decentralized network. That being said, there have also been some software issues. You know, if you follow the chat discussions regarding the Ethereum network, I think the 15.29 release, so the London release, just before they released that update, they discovered that there was a major flaw in it that would have allowed somebody to effectively print infinite amounts of Ethereum. And so, you know, it's still not proven. I know the Berlin release has now been tested on the Rupsten network, and I think Rinkeby, and it's going to on a couple of other test nets. But those test nets have shown that the cost of gas is hugely variable depending on the transactions they run through it, and they're still not really achieving their objective. So I believe that there will likely be a certain amount of dissension in the ranks of the miners who are going to say, listen, we're just going to mine classic Ethereum. We're not going to go to Ether 2.0. And so it'll be very interesting to see. The other thing I think is, you know, the Bitcoin blockchain has been, you know, proven its stability and security. And as you look at more of these DeFi applications and payment systems, what's currently able to be done on Lightning is essentially you can do with Taproot now, you can do smart contracts on Bitcoin, you can do pretty much all the things you can do on the Ethereum network on Bitcoin plus Lightning. And so I think you're going to start seeing people now starting to migrate applications to the Bitcoin blockchain, which again will drive the price of Bitcoin up because more Bitcoin will be consumed. But the Bitcoin blockchain is by far the securest blockchain there is out there just by the sheer volume of miners that are out there and the difficulty of doing any type of takeover. I think there's a lot of FUD to be said about Ethereum 2.0 and proof of stake, just as they try and kind of load it onto proof of work. But similar to global population, the energy required to mine Bitcoin is going to hit an apex here in the next year or two and then start declining. I'm already seeing specifications for Bitcoin miners, mining rigs that are next generation rigs coming out that have half the energy consumption per terahash of current miners with two times the performance. Now, do the math. That's one quarter of the energy per terahash. And so if you start doing that, now you're going to start seeing efficiencies as more and more of the proof of work is done on 100% renewable energy. And as you get energy storage being available for wind and solar, which gives you more of a 24/7 capability, you also will have small nuclear capability that'll start being deployed in North America in 2024 and beyond in two states, which are essentially, think of it as a nuclear power plant in a container that you put next to your mining containers. And it, you know, you have 30 to 100 megawatts of power that runs forever, essentially, at a fixed cost. So I think all of that is going to come into play to really make this whole conversation about the power and energy use of proof of work moot completely and a non-issue.
I always find it surprising, like how some of the issues about proof of stake on Ethereum's proposed kind of change and even the vulnerabilities, you know, of such a major change. And you like said that it might fork and some of the, because it is such a, it's a platform which is marketed as it can do more, but also then kind of introduces so many bugs. Why that is not discussed a lot more, with potential investors in the media. So it always surprises me. In May, Marathon stirred a lot of controversy by adding a comment in a block which you mined. It's a block 682170 on 6th May by adding a comment, OFAC compliant block, OFAC compliant block. The Bitcoin community was obviously outraged because they believe you're trying to signal an alternative type of Bitcoin and goes kind of directly against the principle of fungibility, which is that all Bitcoin tokens are the same. Bitcoiners believe this is a critical feature, of course, of something that we use as money. It's like marking a dollar bill. Then within a few weeks, by end of May, Marathon announced you will no longer signal blocks like this. What was the original motive behind this signaling and why did you reverse it?
Sure. Great question. So I ate a lot of crow, as they say in North America, over that decision. So we had been told by financial institutions that they wanted to buy virgin Bitcoin because they were concerned regarding the fact that Bitcoin may have been mined or held at some point by somebody who was on an OFAC list, a restricted list. And so in theory, they would be in violation of US Treasury rules by transacting business owning that Bitcoin. We were also told that, you know, they would pay extra even for a green Bitcoin. And so our first step was to say, you know, let's see if we can produce a Bitcoin that is OFAC compliant. And we interpreted the rules to be that if a block contained transactions that included wallet addresses that were on an OFAC list, then in theory, the rewards for that block would have been tainted by those wallet addresses in the block. The OFAC rules actually aren't specific into this at all. They, you know, the OFAC rules are that if you engage in business activities with somebody who's on a list, you're in violation. Well, validating a block is not doing business with somebody. It's you're just processing data. And so as soon as we found out from financial institutions, hey, we've got Bitcoin that are OFAC compliant, they said, great, I'm not going to pay you anything extra for it. It was like, okay, that was a waste of time. And then, you know, with all the hubbub in the community, we realized, you know what, this most probably doesn't make sense. And then with Taproot signaling, the software effort for us to do Taproot and be OFAC compliant was going to be considerable. And by just going back to the vanilla node and signaling for Taproot, we could solve all those problems. So we made the decision to say, fine, we made a mistake. You know, it was a bad decision. You know, we went back to doing the same thing everybody else is doing, because to your point, a Bitcoin is a Bitcoin, no matter whether it's green or yellow or blue or whatever. It's still a Bitcoin, and there's nothing special about it in that sense.
Fred, thank you so much for that honest answer. I know I put you in a spot, but as a Bitcoin maxi, I really wanted to know the motive. But thank you so much for that answer. How was Bitcoin Miami, and what were the key takeaways from the conference?
You know, it's interesting because it ties very well into the topic we just talked about. I was on a panel with Kevin O'Leary, and you know, he is definitely give us a green Bitcoin and an OFAC compliant non-Chinese Bitcoin, and the U.S. financial institutions will be all over it. And I had the good-natured fun of being able to tell him, you know, been there, done that. No, they don't want it. They won't pay extra for it. And you know, so that was fun. It was an amazing conference, I think, because obviously the news about El Salvador was quite amazing. Having a country declare Bitcoin legal tender has very far-reaching implications. Most people don't realize this, but as a company, whether you're a miner or just a financial institution, when you hold Bitcoin on your balance sheet, you have to impair that asset when the price goes down, but you don't get to mark the price back up again when the price of Bitcoin goes up again. So you're carrying it on your balance sheet at its maximally impaired value, which is not good for companies because it looks like they're generating these losses every time Bitcoin goes down, but they can't mark a profit when it goes back up. So by changing Bitcoin's nature to legal tender, and it becomes a currency, that changes how you hold it on your balance sheet. So it's only when you actually transact in the Bitcoin that you have a gain or a loss. So just like corporations today that might hold, you know, dollars, euros, pounds, Swiss francs, Singapore dollars, Japanese yen on their balance sheet, they just look at the end of every reporting period and, you know, what's the equivalent exchange rate, and that's what they hold it at the value at. So, you know, we hold the Bitcoin on our balance sheet through a fund instrument that we have created so that it looks like an investment on our balance sheet. So we can mark it to market and don't have to do the impairment in quite the same way. Some of the Bitcoin we hold in our balance sheet is still held as traditional Bitcoin, but the rest is held in a fund of one, as it's called, which we have at NYDIG. But the key fact that it's a legal tender now changes also the taxation. So if you think about it, when you have a Bitcoin and you spend it on something, you have a taxable event, the way the U.S. tax laws and many tax laws in countries operate. If it's currency, that argument is off the table because now it's a currency you acquire. And when you spend it, it was currency and you exchanged it for something of value. So it's a very interesting, you know, change that has very far-reaching repercussions. And it will be very interesting. We've actually asked our accountants, our tax auditors, when do they think that this will impact U.S. tax rules about Bitcoin? Because as soon as anybody recognizes it as legal tender, it now is a currency. And so this will be very interesting. And I think it's a subtle thing that only typically public companies worry about. But, you know, people like MicroStrategy, Tesla, who hold, and ourselves, who hold a lot of Bitcoin on our balance sheet, it has a big impact. But so the El Salvador declaration was a huge thing. 12,000, reportedly maybe 18,000, highly passionate Bitcoin maximalists and other people in a room giving very honest feedback to people. It was amazing. You know, they were booing certain people, they were applauding other people. It really shows the depth of passion that exists in this industry. It's such an exciting. Many years ago, I ran a company that was the leading digital media property for online video games, a company called GameSpot. And we had millions of passionate gamers who were constantly giving us feedback, positive and negative, about every little thing we did because they were so passionate about games and how games operated and what we said about games. And, you know, it's when you have those passionate users, and I don't want to use, they're almost fanatical in their passion. It's just amazing. And, you know, if you can harness that passion, you can do some really amazing things. And I think the key challenge that Bitcoin faces is this transition from a fan-based group of Bitcoin maximalists and then institutional investors over here. And then how do you now blend the two of these together so that you can have stodgy people that wear ties still and suits talk about Bitcoin as passionately as, you know, Bitcoin traders and miners? So
yeah, I was sitting over here in Singapore and I have suffered from FOMO at another level watching my Twitter feed on Bitcoin Miami. And I think the numbers of people in suits being passionate about Bitcoin is just increasing, maybe not as fast as we would like, but definitely increasing. Before we wrap up, how can people find you and find Marathon?
So Marathon, you can find online. Our URL is marathondhfordigitalholdings.com. You can also just, our stock ticker is MARA, Mara. You can find us on any stock quote service. And you can find me on Twitter, FGTHIEL. Just search for Fred Thiel on Google and you'll find me that way too as well. So, or email fred@marathondh.com.
Fred, it's always a pleasure to talk to a Bitcoiner, but in addition, who's also a fellow YPO. Thank you so much for doing this. If you like this video podcast, please like and subscribe. Fred, this was a fascinating conversation. Thank you so much for doing this. And thank you so much for coming on Sunny Bitcoin.
Absolutely. It's been great to be on. It's a pleasure always to chat and catch up on Bitcoin and love your program. So please keep doing it and keep promoting the Bitcoin cause. Thank you.